This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
إلى اليمن حيث أعلنت مصادر مسؤولة أن الجيش
Yemeni officials announced that the army has started wide-scale military operations in the newly secured area of Harf Sufyan, claiming that dozens of armed men have surrendered. The army announced that dozens of Houthis have been killed and injured, and four others were imprisoned during fierce battles that took place last night in Sa'ada in northern Yemen.
The Yemeni army has been employing a scorched earth policy against Houthi rebels for 1 month, and according to experts, these operations have enabled the Yemeni army to achieve visible success in the region. According to Yemeni sources, clashes between the two sides continue to kill and injure dozens of Houthi rebels in Sa'ada, Malahid, Harf al-Sufyan area, the province of Amran, Al-Manzar, and Tibab. Four Houthis were arrested as they were trying to escape to the valleys south of the Qimma area in Sa'ada province. In order to surround the Houthis on land and by sea, military and security units planted landmines and explosive devices along the roads in many areas in Sa'ada. Meanwhile, warplanes were attacking Houthi gatherings and strongholds in the villages of Ad-Darb, Darb Suleiman, Al-Hasm and Al-Jarsha. The Yemeni forces destroyed a number of cars loaded with food supplies, weapons, and ammunition destined for several fortified military locations. The government denied Houthi claims that the army shelled the home of a family in Souq Talih and stated that no civilians were injured during the military attacks. The army is preparing wide-scale offensive operations in Harf Sufyan to clear the area of rebels and reopen the road leading to Sa'ada. However, the Houthis vow an unprecedented resistance effort in Harf Sufyan and claim they have foiled more than 30 attacks by the army and its allied tribes since the war started. Mail Mohandes Al Arabi.
The superpowers of the G6 in charge of inspecting the Iranian nuclear program have received Iran's new proposals for resuming talks with the West. The proposals were handed by the Iranian foreign minister, Manoucher Moutaki, to representatives of Russia, China, France, Britain and Germany, as well as to the Swiss ambassador, who represents U.S. interests in Tehran. The documents were handed to the Western representatives during a ceremony that was held at the headquarters of the Iranian foreign ministry in Tehran.
وزارة الخارجية الإيرانية بطهران حيث أكد متقي أن بلاده مستعدة
Moutaki said that his country is willing to discuss any political, security, economic, cultural and international issues with the West on the principles of respecting the rights and sovereignty of nations.
أو تهديدات حسب قوله.
Meanwhile, the Yemeni president, Ali Abdullah Saleh, drew a line between what he referred to as Iranian groups and the Iranian authority during his latest remarks over the allegations of Iranian support for the Houthis. Saleh said that the Houthis are receiving financial support from certain groups in Iran. The Yemeni president, who didn't officially accuse the Iranian authorities of supporting Houthi rebels, said that Yemeni security forces have uncovered two Yemeni cells who admitted receiving more than $100,000 from groups in Iran. Saleh further said that the Iranian government is maintaining contact with the rebels, which is evidenced by the fact that Tehran has offered to mediate the conflict. The war between the Yemeni army and Houthi rebels has entered its fifth week, with no signs of ending anytime soon. Meanwhile, the roads continue to be closed, which is delaying the return of refugees and hampering relief efforts. The war has stolen the joy of Ramadan from the Yemenis, especially as casualties continue to mount and economic conditions deteriorate. Abid Rahman Al-Shumari reports from Sana'a.
The military confrontation continues to escalate daily, which further complicates the situation on the ground. Meanwhile, the Yemeni army carried out attacks on rebel positions in the area of Thi Sulaiman and Beit al-Kahem, killing several fighters and injuring several others. In addition, the Yemeni forces carried out airborne operations in the area of Talh against the Houthi rebels. This news comes as the number of displaced residents continues to mount.
It seems that the Yemeni government, by launching attacks from the air and on the ground, is trying to control Houthi expansion in the region. The Yemeni government has launched this fierce attack during a political cover-up at the regional and international levels.
The war in Yemen has spoiled the joy of the holy month of Ramadan, which, this year, is affected by violent political circumstances. Ramadan is met with great sadness this year among the Yemenis, not only due to the war in Saada, but also due to the deteriorating economic situation in the country.
Under normal circumstances, Ramadan in Yemen usually brings joy to people. Unfortunately, the war in Saada and in southern Yemen has added a bitter flavor to Ramadan.
The economic situation is directly linked to the general state of affairs in Yemen. It is also affected by the war in Saada.
This is the general mood of the Yemeni public, which is facing security threats as the war in Saada continues to rage and military maneuvers continue to spread in the south. Meanwhile, Al-Qaeda continues to increase their activities. The Yemenis are hoping to find actual remedies that will help get their country back on track. Abdurrahman Al-Shumari, Dubai TV, Sana'a.
الشرطة العراقية أن مدنيا قتل وأصيب خمسة آخرون في تفجير عبر
The Iraqi police reported that an explosion in Al-Qarada in the heart of Baghdad left one civilian dead and five others injured. The police added that the explosion, which targeted an Iraqi police unit, damaged a number of buildings and vehicles.
كما قالت الشرطة العراقية إن شخصين قتلا وأصيب 29
The Iraqi police also said that two people were killed and 29 others were injured when two explosive devices detonated in Al-Mahdoudiya in southern Baghdad. In addition, 19 people were killed, including women and children. 13 others were injured when a booby-trap truck exploded in the Kurdish village of Wardak near the city of Mosul in northern Iraq. Another explosion attempt was foiled by police when they killed the suicide bomber before he was able to blow himself up.
ومعنا من بغداد الكاتب الصحفي قحطان
Joining us from Baghdad, journalist قحطان الخافجي. Mr. Khafiji, every time there is a political crisis, one must ask about the timing. Why are these security breaches taking place now?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
There are several implications about what happened in Iraq today. About 100 people were killed and injured. In fact, the guiding factor behind these explosions is political differences. The Iraqi government has not identified the parties that carry out these attacks, which indicates the perpetrators are free and have their own agenda, different from that of the Iraqi government. The occupation, which causes violent power struggles between the different political parties in Iraq, is the sole factor behind the explosions and fighting.
Assuming that the perpetrators are free and known, why aren't the victims identifying them? And why isn't the government detaining them?
In my humble opinion, there are several reasons behind this. Primarily, the Iraqi security agencies are weak and can't properly carry out their missions. Also, some political parties are collaborating with Iraqi officials, making it possible for the perpetrators to carry out such attacks. Perhaps the contradictory statements made by different Iraqi senior government officials show they differ on whether measures should be taken against the responsible parties. This situation demonstrates that the Iraqi government is in a state of panic and has failed.
We thank journalist Qahtan Al-Khafiji joining us from Baghdad.
In an effort to create an environment suitable for the return of internally displaced Iraqis and refugees to their original places of residence,
the Iraqi Ministry of Displacement and Migration continues to hold periodic meetings in cooperation with donor countries. The ministry seeks to establish a registry system in order to help to monitor the flow of returnees and to assess their needs.
The Iraqi Ministry of Displacement and Migration continues to hold occasional meetings and consultation sessions geared towards establishing a registry system for Iraqi returnees. The ministry will compile information on the returnees and store it in a registry. The ministry hopes that the registry will help them better monitor the flow of returnees and assess their needs.
The returnees can find information in the registry. Some of the information that can be found in the registry are the names and addresses of the various ministries or departments, and where they can find help. The returnees must register with the ministry in order to receive assistance.
Legal experts who attended the Ministry of Displacement meetings said that the registry provided the returnees some of the legal privileges available to them. The registry also lists the names of agencies where the returnees can gain access to organized support and public assistance.
The registry lists the rights and privileges available to Iraqi returnees. The returnees, once registered, can demand the rights and benefits available to them.
Representatives from the Danish embassy attended today's meeting, hosted by the Ministry of Displacement and Migration. The Danish delegation said their role is to coordinate meetings between the ministry and donor countries, which are taking part in the formation of the registry.
We hope to be an effective part of this process by providing better services to the returnees. We're seeking more cooperation and consultation in order to secure more grants for social services so they can help families in need.
It's worth mentioning that today's meeting is the third and last such meeting by the ministry. The ministry will make recommendations and issue instructions at the end of today's meeting. The registry will include a list of rights and privileges available to the families in need. Ather Al-Deli, Rakia, Baghdad.
In another development, the Iraqi High Criminal Court ruled today for the release of Faisal Ataya Nasser al-Sadoun and Khalif Hussein al-Sharifi, the two defendants implicated in the killing of two British soldiers in 1991. The court's decision was based on a lack of sufficient evidence.
Due to the lack of evidence, the two defendants, Khalif Hussein Mufti Sharifi and Faisal Ataya Nasser al-Sadoun, have been acquitted in accordance with Article 13 of the 2005 Iraqi High Criminal Court. The court hereby drops all charges facing the two defendants. The defendants will be immediately released, provided that they are not wanted in connection with another case.
Hi, I'm Jamal Dajani. As you may know, we are in the middle of our yearly fundraising drive. This is the one time of year that we raise money specifically for Mosaic. The program you're watching right now is only made possible with your support. Our goal is $200,000. That's how much we need to continue our uncensored reporting through the end of the year. We can only reach this goal if each and every one of you pitch in whatever you can. So when you're done watching this episode, consider making a donation to keep programs like Mosaic alive. Thank you.
Syrian Foreign Minister Walid al-Mualim called for the achievement of Arab solidarity, increasing Arab coordination, putting differences aside, and focusing on commonalities in order to face the many challenges and risks. Al-Mualim, who presided over the Arab Foreign Minister's meeting at the Arab League headquarters in Cairo, reiterated the Arab state's support for a just and comprehensive peace based on UN resolutions and the Arab Peace Initiative. However, this Arab position is met by an Israeli lack of will to make peace. Israel wants to continue the occupation, and it refuses to abide by international resolutions and recent peace initiatives. He said that the goal of the Israeli policy is to destroy the Palestinian cause.
The continuation of the Israeli occupation and the violation of the legitimate rights of the Palestinian people are the primary challenges we are facing today. At this time, we are facing an Israeli policy that is based on the intention to eliminate the Palestinian cause while continuing settlement construction in all of its forms to Judify Jerusalem, not to mention the killing, land confiscation, the siege, and the policy of starvation. Gaza today is a testimony for all of this. Statements by Israeli officials, their actions and maneuvers, prove beyond a doubt there is no Israeli partner for peace.
Al-Mualim said that the U.S. engagement in the peace process is a positive matter, and it opens a window of opportunity. However, he said that peace obligations were already agreed upon during previous peace talks, including the stopping of all settlement expansion and the ending of the siege against the Palestinians. He added that accepting anything less than that is dangerous and harmful to our cause and would only make Israel more stubborn. He said that the window of opportunity can't be used for normalizing relations with Israel in exchange for a settlement freeze, because the construction of settlements is illegal to begin with, and Israel must stop the construction of settlements in accordance with international law. Al-Mualim said that the Arab Peace Initiative is already a big step taken by Arab states as a confidence-building measure. Israel, however, did not do anything in return to increase the confidence of Arab states. Al-Mualim added that the divisions among Palestinians are very harmful to the Palestinian cause. He reiterated that Palestinian unity is required, and achieving it must become an Arab and Palestinian priority. He pointed to the efforts that were exerted by Syria towards achieving Palestinian national unity. The Syrian foreign minister reiterated Syria's support for Iraq's stability and security, as well as the political process.
Syria completely supports Iraq's unity, sovereignty, security, and stability. Syria also supports the political process in Iraq and considers its security and stability important to the security of Syria and the Arab nation. Syria has worked to strengthen its bilateral relations with our brothers in Iraq, and we were hurt by their latest explosions on Bloody Wednesday. We have condemned these explosions, but we were surprised when those in charge in Iraq accused us of being responsible for these explosions. These developments are very regrettable, and do not serve the interests of Iraq or Syria. Rather, they harm the Arabs in general. We are open to solutions for the current crisis based on providing reasonable evidence.
شهد المؤتمر الوزاري العربي في القاهرة عقد لقاء بين
The Iraqi foreign minister and his Syrian counterpart met on the sidelines of the Arab foreign minister's meeting underway in Cairo. Also participating on the sidelines were the secretary general of the Arab League and the Turkish foreign minister. Syrian foreign minister Walid al-Mualim announced that his country and Iraq have agreed to stop media rhetoric and form joint security committees as well as reinstate their country's ambassadors.
Many issues have topped the agenda of the Arab foreign ministers meeting underway in Cairo. Most of the issues have been outstanding for years, with the exception of the Syrian-Iraqi issue. On the sidelines of the conference, a four-way meeting was held among foreign ministers of Syria, Iraq, and Turkey, as well as the Secretary General of the Arab League. Despite the fact that the meeting ended with both countries agreeing to form joint security committees to discuss their country's problems, Iraq's foreign minister reiterated his country's demand for an international inquiry by the Security Council.
The position of the Iraqi government on this issue is very clear. The Iraqi position is unified and cohesive. We will do everything to spare the lives of the Iraqi people from threats of any source.
Did Syria accept this Iraqi position?
Syria is confident that it has no connection in the August 19th bombings. I would like to confirm from a Syrian position that the Iraqi decision to move the case to the International Court of Justice is merely an Iraqi affair and does not concern us.
Normalizing relations with Israel was another hot topic on the agenda of the Arab League conference in Cairo. While some Arab foreign ministers insisted that the issues of a settlement freeze and the resumption of negotiations may lead to normalizing relations with Israel, Amir Moussa said that the normalization process will not begin before the restoration of all Arab rights.
Every issue on the table is being linked to the issue of a settlement freeze. Israel has openly and publicly said that it will continue its settlement activities. As I said 2 days ago, the file has been closed because Israel obviously hasn't stopped its settlement campaign.
The Arab foreign ministers have not adopted a clear and preemptive position ahead of unveiling the U.S.-sponsored initiative for peace. The Arab ministers opted to leave room for maneuver by the Arab Initiative Committee, which is expected to meet on the sidelines of the UN General Assembly meeting in New York at the end of the month. The minister also adopted the same position of the Palestinian foreign minister, who said there will be no negotiations before the halting of all settlement activities.
Well, the plot thickens and we still have no definitive answers. But a top Kremlin official has confirmed that Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu did make a clandestine trip to Moscow on Monday. The Prime Minister's office is still not confirming or denying. A lot of questions remain unanswered, and while the Prime Minister's office was still dealing with that issue today, it was gloating over an unexpected victory for Netanyahu regarding Likud hardliners. Eli Wagelanter has that story.
The confirmation in the Russian newspaper of Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's trip comes despite a statement yesterday from the Kremlin press service saying that nothing is known about reports of the visit. But newspapers in Russia today are filled with rumors about the trip. The Kommersant paper quotes an informed Israeli source as saying, quote, such a visit could be related to new information and could threaten the Iranian nuclear program. It should not be ruled out that Israel may be ready to move on to decisive actions with regards to Iran, and Netanyahu has decided to inform the Kremlin of this. Last night, the Prime Minister's office published yet another announcement on the mysterious disappearance of Netanyahu on Monday. The Prime Minister was busy with a confidential and classified activity. It doesn't say with whom, or where, or why. What is almost as mysterious as whether the trip took place is what might have been discussed. Speculation focuses on informing Russia about an attack on Iran and President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, the possible Russian arms deals to Iran and Syria, or the disappearance of the Arctic Sea cargo ship suspected of carrying Russian-made S-300 anti-aircraft missiles bound for Iran that went missing last month. Meanwhile, in the midst of all this international intrigue, Netanyahu did score internal political points last night. A Likud rally in favor of continued construction in Judea and Samaria was supposed to include a number of sympathetic ministers, but none showed up. Four Likud MKs did attend, but at first it was predicted that as much as half the faction would show, including four ministers and coalition chairman Zev Elkin. But Netanyahu personally pressured ministers not to attend. I respect your opinion in favor of construction, but the press is making the rally into a political clash, so anyone who comes would be seen as acting against me, Netanyahu reportedly told the ministers. Your coming would be seen as a political statement against me and not an ideological one in favor of the settlements. Eli Wogelanter, IBA News.
Well, Iran has dismissed foreign media reports that a number of those people killed during the unrest following the country's presidential election were secretly buried. The reports follow the burials of tens of unidentified corpses in a special section of the Behesh Zahra Cemetery in southern Tehran. An official in charge of the cemetery told us who the unidentified bodies really belong to.
پزشکی قانونی منظورم هست اینا هویتشون مشخص نیست برای اونها و در اثر حوادث فوت شدن تصادف یا کارتون خواب هستن یا اعتیاد داشتن یا سوانح طبیعی بوده اوراق شناسایی همراهشون نبوده هویتشون برای پزشکی قانونی مجهول بوده اینا به عنوان مرد ناشناس زن ناشناس یا مجهول الهویه با مدارک پزشکی معتبر اعزام میشن به بهشت زهرا ما برابر آمارمون هفته 10 تا اموات مجهول الهویه داریم.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic video podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.